Well, good morning. Happy Easter. He is risen. Can we make a joyful noise for that? We are so glad that you are with us this morning. Good morning to all those joining us for church online. We're glad that you are with us as well. If you would, jump up for the Lord and let's go to Him to bless our service this morning. Father, we thank you so much for this morning, an opportunity to gather and to celebrate the resurrection of your Son. We thank you for your Son and the gift of eternal life that He gave each and every one of us when He, on that Friday, hung on that cross and took the weight of the world's sins upon His shoulders. But Father, you promised that He would rise, and He did. He conquered death. And so this morning, again, we celebrate the resurrection of your Son, and I just pray that you would bless our time together this morning, that you would speak through me the words that you want to lay on our hearts. We love you so much. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. And through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory. Seal the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Jesus.
Turn and greet somebody this morning.
Get, oh God, are you getting nuts?
Well, if you would, grab your bulletins for a whole whopping two announcements this morning. The food pantry item for this week is toilet paper. And then also, don't forget that coming next month, we will be finalizing our plans for our couples Bible study. Hopefully, we'll get that in the next couple weeks pinned down. But that's all I have for announcements this morning. So now that you're nice and comfortable, jump back up for the Lord and let's continue celebrating and worshiping Him this morning.
Angels and
This morning, as we gather around the table, it is going to look a little different, but the meaning will be the same. You may notice off to the side here, the cross has bread on it. I want to remind you this morning of Jesus' words in John chapter 6, where he simply says, "I am the bread of life." Later on in that chapter, he goes on to say, "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world." And so this morning, we together, as we celebrate Christ's resurrection, are going to come to the cross and take and eat this bread that represents Christ's body. We're going to sing our communion song. And then after that, Mike and Mark are going to come up and get the juice ready. And once they do that and you start to hear the music play, if you would, please get up and come to this west side and come down this aisle and come up and pull a piece of bread off the cross and then walk toward the middle and take the juice and put it back in the tray, and then you can go back to your seat. For those of you who would like to not come up forward, if you would, just simply raise your hand and I will bring you communion this morning. So this morning, as we celebrate Christ's resurrection, let's come to the cross and eat and give thanks for the bread of life offered for the sins of the people all around the world.
Thank you.
Thank you.
join me in saying the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Just a reminder that this is the last Sunday of the month, and so there is no nursery this morning. If you have your Bibles this morning, turn to Matthew chapter 27. And while you are turning there, we have spent the last 3 weeks in a series titled Love Reigns. We've looked at all the ways that God's amazing love transforms our past, how it transforms our present, and our future. It was the love of God that caused Jesus to come to earth and to offer himself as a sacrifice on the cross to forgive the world of its sins. It is the love of God that continually offers us a new life through this risen Savior. And so this morning we do celebrate, because this morning we worship and we have worshiped the risen Jesus. If you think about life, love is the driving force behind our sacrificial actions, whether it's towards our family, our friends, our husbands, our wives. We will gladly pay any price to demonstrate how much we care. Love is powerful. And love, it causes us and moves us to do some amazing things. Before there ever was an Easter Sunday, there was a Good Friday. Before there was a resurrection, there first had to be a death. If you're taking notes this morning, this is our first point. There can only be one king. For 33 years, Jesus Christ walked on this earth while he was serving the hungry, he was healing the broken, delivering the oppressed. He announced the coming kingdom of God and the restoration of all things. He claimed to be the Son of God. And there was many who did believe him to be the true king of all things. And that kind of thinking and teaching caused a lot of conflict in the area that Jesus served in. At this time, the ruler of ancient Near East was Rome. And Rome had instilled a vassal king named Herod the Great. And Herod the Great's job was to keep things in Israel all under control. Herod was a tyrant. He was constantly afraid that his authority would be undermined. Another potential king would be a threat to Roman rule and therefore had to be eradicated. Both Herod and Jesus could not reign over Israel. So the Jewish religious leaders and the Roman centurions worked together to have Jesus arrested. And because of that, he was brought to trial for his claims to be God. He was convicted and he was beaten nearly to death, and then he was forced to carry a rugged wooden cross all the way up the hill that he would be killed upon. And so if you have your Bibles open to Matthew 27, follow along as I read verses 32 through 42. As they were going out, they met a man from Cyrene named Simon, and they forced him to carry the cross. They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There they offered Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall, but after tasting it, he refused to drink it. When they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots. And sitting down, they kept watch over him there. Above his head they placed the written charge against him, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Two rebels were crucified with him on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, You who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God. In the same way, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders, they mocked him. He saved others, they said, but he can't save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. The crucifixion of Jesus is marked by ridicule and disbelief. The soldiers mocked Jesus by placing that sign over his head, calling him the King of the Jews, even though they didn't believe it. Those who passed by mocked Jesus by telling him to save himself if he was really the Son of God. The priests, the teachers mocked Jesus by telling him to get off the cross if he really was the King of Israel. You see, none of them, not a single one of them, understood that the true test of Jesus' power and authority was not in his ability to take himself off the cross. His true power and authority was in his ability to overcome the death that the crucifixion would result in. And I think in our lives, sometimes we miss the proof of Jesus' lordship because we're expecting him to prove himself in certain ways. And he does something different. We have a lot of people in our world that have decided in their hearts that they will never trust in Jesus unless he meets their expectations. Unless Jesus heals their relatives, gives them a job, stops world hunger, or writes something in the sky. They will never trust him, and they will never obey his authority in their lives. Because they can never allow themselves to see him as king unless he does what they want him to do. And I'm afraid this morning that this kind of mentality is the same kind of struggle that plagued those who were there at Jesus' death. It's the same mentality that drove Herod to be a part of the death of God's Son. If you're taking notes this morning, when we demand Jesus to prove himself on our terms, we rob ourselves of seeing his work in our lives. Herod was not the last one to be threatened by the kingship of Jesus. He was not the only one to struggle with this idea of Jesus being in charge. The truth is, that is still an idea that we have a hard time with today. I have this chair up here this morning. This chair represents our lives. When you look at our lives, there can only be one king as well. It's been said that on the throne of our heart sits the one who reigns our lives. And see, you and I, we choose. We choose whether that will be Jesus that sits on the throne of our lives or if it will be ourselves. You see, when we're on the throne of our lives, on the throne of our hearts, then we make decisions based on what we want, which causes us to live selfishly. The other choice that we have is to put Jesus on the throne of our lives. And when we do that, when Jesus is on the throne of our lives, that's when love reigns. We listen to his leading. We put others first. We live sacrificially. So when it comes to the way that we speak and the way that we act and the way that we live, there can only be one king. If Jesus is dead, then none of this matters. But since he is risen from the dead, that changes everything. He is king. Second point this morning, love overcame death. 3 days after Jesus was crucified and laid in the tomb, to everyone's shock and amazement, he appeared in bodily form to many of the disciples and others. How many others? 500, to be exact. 500 people saw the risen Lord. That had never happened before. They all watched him hang on the cross. They all watched him die. They knew he was dead. They saw him put in the tomb. The disciples stood there and remembered back just a couple days before eating with him. They remembered walking with him. They remembered talking with him. Jesus' love for humanity had overcome death. It defeated evil once and for all. His resurrection is proof that he was indeed the true king over all. In the January 6th, 1993 edition of our Daily Bread, there is this story in there that talks about this renowned artist by the name of Paul Gustav Dor, who lived from 1821 to 1883, was in Europe when he lost his passport. When he came to a border crossing, he explained his predicament to one of the guards. Giving his name to the official, Dor hoped he would be recognized and he'd be allowed just to go through. The guard, however, said that many people attempted to cross the border by claiming to be persons they were not. And so he needed proof. Dor insisted that he was the man he claimed to be. The official said, "All right, we'll give you a test. If you pass it, we'll allow you to go through." So they handed him a pencil, they handed him a piece of paper, and they told the artist to sketch several people standing nearby. Dor did it so quickly and skillfully that the guard was convinced he was indeed who he claimed to be. His work was confirmed. Jesus' work confirmed his word as well. And though there were many who doubted him, there was many who mocked him, death did not have the last say or the final word. Love did. And the scriptures tells us that this is true in one of the most famous passages of all. John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." God loved the world so much that he sent Jesus to live and to die. And when you and I, when we put our faith and our hope and our trust in Jesus' life and his death and his resurrection, we will be saved. And that's why we celebrate this morning. Because you and I, we have been given an opportunity for eternal life. We know that because of Jesus, the worst thing that will happen to us will not be the last thing that happens to us, because we will experience resurrection and a new life. After Jesus had resurrected, his final words to his followers revealed to us the truth behind the Easter story. Flip over to Matthew 28, beginning in verse 18. "Then Jesus came to them and he said, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age.'" Easter. Easter is the day that Jesus was given all authority in heaven and on earth. No matter how many people doubted, no matter how many people mocked him, he is the King of the Jews. He was able to rescue himself and the entire world as well. No matter how many questioned his power, he defeated the cross once and for all. The love of God was the authority and was now reigning over the entire world and our lives as well. And so his final instruction for all of his followers was to go into the whole world and make disciples. He told them to go and spread the good news of his resurrection and his love to all who would listen. We, all of us, have been invited to teach the way of Jesus because it changes the world. Last point this morning is simple. let love reign in you. This morning, if you consider yourself a Christian, that instruction has been given to you as well. You are to be a part of making disciples. The Greek word used in this passage for disciple is a word that means learner or student. We are to allow ourselves to be students. We are to be learners of the way of Christ and to help others become learners and students as well. It holds with it this feeling of progression. To be a disciple, to be in a lifelong process of becoming more like Jesus. And over time, we learn to live generous lives. We learn to forgive. We learn to go and to serve others. We learn to practice self-control. And we learn to be people of peace. When we submit to the love of Jesus in our lives, then we are compelled to live like Him and invite others to join us. That is what it means to let love reign in us. This final reminder that we are given by Jesus before He ascends into heaven is that He will always be with us until the very end. And maybe this morning you feel like God has maybe forgotten about you. I want to remind you that you are never alone. Because Jesus lives and dwells inside of those who trust in Him by the power of the Holy Spirit. This means that no matter what you're going through, no matter what you face, you're never alone. This morning, I am convinced that in this room, and even those watching online, that there are two types of people. The first group is this. There are some here who have never decided to let love reign in their lives and to follow Jesus. And maybe you've been waiting for Jesus to prove Himself to you, and it hasn't happened yet. Or maybe you don't want to give up control of your life, so you've never submitted to Jesus. This morning, I want to invite you to give your life to Jesus. I want to invite you to offer Him your heart and become a disciple and a student of His for the rest of your life. If that's something that you would want to do, I would love to visit with you after the service and set up a time that we can have you make that decision and be buried in the waters of baptism. The other group of people here this morning or online are those who have trusted in Jesus. But maybe we've grown tired of obeying Him. Maybe we've strayed from Him and have lived for ourselves. Easter reminds us that we can once again repent and obey. And if that's you today, I want to remind you that Jesus promised to never leave us. He still loves you, and He's still with you. Commit once again to live for Him. This Easter, may you see the resurrection of Jesus Christ as the proof of His love, and may you let that love reign inside of you and your life. And may you join God in spreading the good news to the entire world. He is risen. Happy Easter. Father, we do celebrate. You kept your promise. You went through a beating that none of us can even begin to imagine this morning. You hung on that cross with the weight of the world's sins on your shoulders out of love and grace. You said you would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, and you kept your word. You always keep your word. Always keep your promises. And so, Father, this morning, wherever we are, I pray and hope that we would look to You and know that You are with us each and every day and every step we take. We love you so much. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen.
Would you stand and sing our final song with us? Awesome week.